Hey there, Waterloo Undergrounders. You're listening to The New Lou on Waterloo Underground. This is Miriam and my co-host for tonight, Johnny, and I will be bringing you the first episode of The New Lou. Yes, indeed. We've been playing the Kinks. We'll continue to play the Kinks. We love them. But we're expanding into including all the other great groups that sprang out of Britain in the 60s and even maybe a little bit before and after. This first episode is going to be an introduction into that world with an interview with our friend, great rock and roller, author, and bon vivant, Max Décharné, whose fantastic book, King's Road, has just been issued with a massive edition of several hundred pages. This gigantic tome is absolutely essential for anyone interested in music, film, and fashion that came out of London in the mid-60s and completely took over the world and has its influence felt right up through today and probably will be for the rest of eternity. We sure hope so. So let's listen in to this chat with the fantastic Max Décharné. Remember to pick up his book, King's Road, from Omnibus Press. And welcome to The New Lou at Waterloo Underground, Kicksville Radio.
Hi, this is Max Décharné, author of King's Road, The Rise and Fall of the Hippest Street in the World, and you're listening to Waterloo Underground.
Hey there, Waterloo Undergrounders. We're here with you at Kicksville Radio, and we are bringing you today a great chat with the incredible Max Décharné, who is the author of the just-released King's Road, the new version of it, over 500 pages on the rise and fall of the hippest street in the world, King's Road, London, England, brought to you by Omnibus Press. And, oh, man, Omnibus is everywhere. I remember when they were starting out there in England, London, New York, Paris, Sydney, Copenhagen, Boston, Madrid, Tokyo, the world. So we're so excited to have this book being presented here and really excited about having a great musician and rock and roll guy who knows all about everything, Max Décharné, recently released from the juvenile detention facility there in Chelsea. And he's gracing our presence. So thank you very much. And welcome, Max.
Thank you, Miriam. Thank you, John. It's really, I'm delighted to be asked. So, very good to talk to you.
Okay. Well, let's dive right in. You know, this book came out what year originally and how much expansion has occurred with it?
Yeah, what happened was it occurred to me one day in about 2003 that two of my favorite bands that ever came out of England, both started down the same road, King's Road. So you've got the Rolling Stones in 1962 living at the scuzzy end of it. And then you've got the Sex Pistols, obviously, basically getting together around Malcolm McLaren and William Westwood's shop in 1975. And I just thought, as soon as I went down that route, I thought, hang on. But then there's Mary Quant with a miniskirt. And then there's at one end of the King's Road, there is the Royal Court Theatre. So you've got the Angry Young Men in the 50s. You've got John Osborne writing Look Back in Anger. And then this explosion of films that came out of that, like Taste of Honey, Saturday Night, Sunday Morning, etc. You've got all the clothes. When I was growing up, I was an early teenage Bolan fan, you know, T-Rex, Slade, Mott the Hoople, Bowie. Half of them were living down the King's Road at the time, but if you saw them, we would watch Top of the Pops, the weekly BBC music show, and half of what you saw these people wearing, you couldn't get clothes like that down where I was living on the south coast of England. You had to go down the King's Road. So the highest platform boots or the most outrageous fashion. And a lot of films, key films like Blow Up, Clockwork Orange, were bits of them shot up and down the King's Road. And it's a very small place. You can walk up and down it in about 20 minutes. It's not like, I think Broadway is what, 8 miles long? So if you said, today I'm going to walk the whole length of Broadway, that's going to take a while. Whereas you can do the whole of the King's Road in a very, very short space. It came out in 2005, and I interviewed a lot of people for it. And it came out in a blaze of publicity. And the way these things go, hardback came out in 2005, paperback came out in 2006. It was then triumphantly remaindered in 2007. If you wanted a copy of it,
you couldn't
get it except secondhand anytime since then.
Okay.
And I had written, even in the early draft of it, I'd written a lot more than I actually used. I think it was about 300-320 pages at the time. So last year what I did was I expanded it by a great deal and rewrote a lot of things. There's also some interviews with a couple of people that were not in the original book. And it still covers the same time frame, which is essentially the 50s, 60s and 70s. Stops at the end of the 70s, after which you had to be really incredibly wealthy to live on the King's Road or open a shop. So I wasn't interested in telling the story of lots of rich people in recent decades in Chelsea. So, yeah, that's the book which came out a couple of months ago. In fact, I think it's only come out in America maybe just a few weeks ago.
Yeah, it's hot off the press.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it is. It's a lot bigger. And unfortunately, some of the great people I interviewed for it in the past are no longer with us. I interviewed John Peel at great length.
Yeah.
He didn't actually live to see the book come out. And quite a few other key people like Mick Farren, my old friend Nicky Sudden from the Swell Maps, all sorts of people, Colin Wilson, the great writer. So part of this is almost, it's like a time capsule. I'm glad I caught them when I did. I managed to get hold of Mary Quant in 2005. She very kindly interviewed me.
Wow, that's great.
Let me interview her. And she did, actually public UK Publication Day, which was April the 13th this year. So a few months prior to the American release. I woke up and the first thing I saw on the news was that Mary had died. So terrible. There's no way she needed to talk to me. She never heard of me. I think she'd sold her business a couple of years before I talked to her to a Japanese concern for over £200 million. She was really, really just very gracious, very friendly, and had so many memories because she didn't just know other people in the fashion business. She knew the writers, she knew musicians, she knew the actors at the Royal Court, you know, your Michael Caines and your Peter O'Toole's. She was just a Venn diagram of everybody who was hip, basically, in the 60s.
Is she a good place to start to talk about?
I think she is.
Book?
Absolutely, because although I do actually begin the book, because Chelsea was a little village outside London back 400 years ago. You know, there were 30 people living there in the time of Henry VIII, so you're talking sort of the 1530s. So I tell the story of how it became the King's Road. It was built for King Charles II in the 17th century. But really when things start getting going, when it starts to be an absolute, just one thing happening after another, Mary Quant moving in there and opening her boutique in 1955. It's called Bazaar. And she started out in a bedsit, just like one room with a sewing machine. She didn't even realize you could buy cloth wholesale. You'd go into Harrods and buying over the counter and paying, you know, top dollar. And the stuff started selling so fast as soon as she opened, she would be staying up half the night making enough clothes to have something to sell the following day. And by, I think, 3 years later, that's 1955, 3 or 4 years later, she's selling to JCPenney across America. And the idea that if you're a clothes designer from England, that anyone elsewhere in the rest of the world was going to be interested. You know, the world looked to Paris. We over here in England, we had hundreds of years of looking to Paris for the latest fashions. So, and the same with music. There's a, I think 1 year later, we had this sort of rockabilly, proto-rockabilly explosion called Skiffle, which a lot of people obviously will know about. And the big hero of that, our first guy, was Lonnie Donegan. He got in the Billboard charts the same, I think a couple of weeks before Heartbreak Hotel got in the Billboard charts. He was one of our first examples of people coming from England and going to America and essentially re-importing rock and roll. So this is before the British invasion. But the second people who did that was a little skiffle group who started out in a coffee bar on the King's Road, and they were called the Chas McDevitt Skiffle Group. And they went from playing in this little coffee bar that could sit, well, like the sort of places that Dylan was playing in the village when he really started. You hear those bootlegs, and there's 30 people in the audience or something like that. And the following year, they're on the Ed Sullivan Show, on the same show as the Adelaide Ones, performing the song called Freight Train. Don't know where. So that's when it starts reaching out, and Look Back in Anger came out in 1956. And within 2 years, that was opening on Broadway with the original King's Road cast. And Gore Vidal's writing about it in very upmarket American literary magazines.
But it started humbly, all of it, the fashion, the music, everything just kind of created itself.
Yeah, on a low budget, really.
You could. Yeah, really low budget, yeah. And with Mary Quant, did she just come up with these ideas all by herself? Did she draw inspiration from other places? Because that was, her fashions were so landmark, or the simple designs, the logo, everything about it, and it related, you know, by the time it was really happening big time here, I remember, you know, it was, Mary Quant was synonymous with the great music that was coming out of Britain, and that's the way people wanted to look, well, the young girls wanted to look particularly.
Sure. And over here, it was, she had that. I mean, by the beginning of the 60s, just in time for the whole Merseybeat thing to explode. And we had a great live show over here called Ready, Steady, Go, which would be very familiar to you. And one of the attractions of that was broadcasting from central London, from Holborn, just near Fleet Street, was that you could be elsewhere in the country and you could watch these hip London kids dancing to the latest music and watching what they were wearing, because these were the super hip people who had been going to Chelsea and buying things from Mary Quant. And by the mid-60s, shops like Hung On You, which then mutated into various other, it's the same building, but that became Mr. Freedom, then it became Paradise Garage, but then it became Let It Rock when McLaren and Westwood turned took over, then it became Sex, then it became Seditioners. And it's still what was Vivian's shop, still is Vivian's shop, even though she's not there anymore. So, yeah, it was a window into the hip world, the music, who's wearing these fashions. Yeah, she wasn't trying to lay claim to it, because if you, and particularly if you look at pre-war, early sort of sci-fi films, you can see people wearing things that look like skirts in Flash Gordon, you know. But the idea of walking along the street, there's a great interview that I quote in the book with Michael Caine on a British chat show about 20 years ago. And Michael, and he shared a flat with Terence Stamp at the wrong end of King's Road. So he knew it. And it was a place to just go and sit and have a coffee or there's one pub called the Chelsea Potter, which you've got a wraparound window. You could sit in that window and just watch everybody go by. You watch the parade. And the King's Road became the place where if you wanted to see miniskirts, you knew they were going to be shorter. You might have read about them in the paper, but they got the tourists coming because they were a couple of inches shorter on the King's Road than anywhere else. People felt they could be more daring, which they could. And so Michael Caine on this chat show, he said, his mum asked him around about 1965, so the miniskirt, what's all this about then? What's going on? And he said, well, so mum, have you ever seen one? Said, no. You know, this is like a middle-aged lady from South London, working class. He goes, all right, and Saturday, which was the great people watching day, I'll take you down the King's Road. So he did that. And he said, right, so you could see somebody coming towards them. And the way he expressed it was with a miniskirt up to here, sort of almost shoulder level. And he said his mum didn't say a thing as this woman walked past. So he just went, so, what do you think then? And his mum just went, if it's not for sale, you shouldn't put it in the window.
I saw that quote that you used as the chapter heading. I loved it. I am a ginger group girl, living in a ginger group world. Hey, Miss Muffet.
Chelsea look, the London beat, designed by Mary Kwan.
But that was always, because things didn't move as fast as they do nowadays. And if you were even half an hour train ride outside London, the fashions would not be as extreme. And you had to wait maybe a year or two to see, you know, whether it was the short skirts or the height of the platform boots in the early 70s or the extreme punk fashions. I mean, there's that thing where Chelsea, for a while, it was just, that was where you'd find it. Whatever it is, you could find a restaurant like Alvaro's, 1966. The Rolling Stones had an account there. Ken Adam, who was designing all the Bond film sets, you know, the massive things that were being shot outside, things like the huge inside of the volcano for You Only Live Twice. He's the man who came up with that. Or the sets for Doctor Strangelove, the War Room set. So there's Ken Adam lunching with Len Deighton, who's writing The Epicress File and Funeral in Berlin. There's the Rolling Stones in that corner. There's Mary Quant, who told me she went there all the time. And this is a room, Alvaro's is now a stationery shop. You can go in there and just buy some pens and some paper and stuff. It's about the size of your average front room.
Is it safe to say that fashion is the one thread that runs through the whole thing? You have tons of stories in the book that are amazing.
Yeah.
Talk about movies and music. But the reason why the people are there is because of the fashion, really.
I would say it's the fashion and the music. The thing is, you've got Mary Quant in 1955, but by this is when skiffle started kicking off, and by 56, you've got the Chas McDonald skiffle group, and you've got this old variety theatre, it was a music hall, halfway down the King's Road called the Chelsea Palace. And it went out of business and turned into a TV studio. So our equivalent of the Ed Sullivan Show was a thing called Chelsea at Nine. This was broadcasting to the nation from about 1957 onwards. And if anybody famous was in town, and when I say famous, I'm talking Ella Fitzgerald, Billie Holiday, really serious jazz people, rock and roll people occasionally, but also people like Peter Sellers just coming on and chatting about his latest book. That was broadcasting live from the King's Road on a Sunday evening at 9 o'clock. So these kind of things were also helping to give, you know, it wasn't called, Birmingham at Nine or Portsmouth at Nine. It was called Chelsea at Nine. So it puts people's, their antenna starts twitching and they think this is where things are happening. And it shows up in the gossip columns, you know, the TV reviews. And I tracked down, again, I've no idea how I got this guy, but he was the set designer, the art director for Granada TV, the TV company we're making Chelsea at Nine. So he was there when the night Billie Holiday played. He was there when Sophia Loren and Peter Sellers were there, and he built the set that they performed in front of. And I said, well, where did you drink? And there's a pub across the road called the Six Bells. So he said, oh, we're drinking the Six Bells in the early 60s. And I said, okay, anybody famous in there? He said, well, I was drinking with the Yardbirds and the Rolling Stones. And I was like, you were drinking with the Yardbirds? And he went, well, my brother Hamish, he was managing the Yardbirds. Ah, right. So then we got onto something else. The crossovers between the art people, the film people, the music, I don't think you can separate it too much because they really did all know each other. And the photographs that were being taken, for instance, the front cover of the Sgt. Pepper LP is obviously the Beatles in 67 standing in front of a load of cardboard cutouts of famous people, like Edgar Allan Poe and all these figures, and then a load of flowers, a floral arrangement. That's a place called Chelsea Manor Studios, which is about 50 yards south of the King's Road. So if you'd have been there on the right day, you've got the Beatles showing up in a couple of cabs, Peter Blake and his wife, Jan Howard, constructing this thing, and them saying, right, stand there and we'll take the pictures. But also a couple of years earlier, you know, the band cover, the Beatles Yesterday and Today cover, the Butcher cover, with where they thought it was a great idea to pose in white lab coats and dismembered dolls and offcuts and leaves.
Yeah,
that's a photo studio, a different photo studio, but it's about 100 yards north of the King's Road, very near where McLaren and Westwood shot.
Michael Cooper had a studio?
Yes, Michael Cooper's studio was at Chelsea Manor. Is a building, it's still there, and it's still a studio. And it's in different units. It's a bit like somebody saying, I worked in the Brill building. You know, you could be there and a lot of other people there. That's where Michael Cooper was, absolutely right, yeah. So you could run into all sorts of people. You know, the great film, that, again, I mentioned Granada TV, who were running that Chelsea at Nine show. They're the ones who were hip enough to film the Stones in Hyde Park in 69. But in 68, that great half-hour film, The Doors at the Roundhouse, when they came over, played at the Roundhouse, which is in Camden Town. But where would you find, I interviewed Mick Parron, as I mentioned. He told me the place you would find Jim Morrison during their stay was in the window of the Chelsea Potter, that pub that I mentioned, taking mountains of substances and just watching the parade go by. Even though he was from somewhere very hip, you know, he knew the whole Sunset Strip whiskey a go go end of things. But this was the King's Road, and that was worth keeping an eye on. It's where Frank Sinatra went to eat when he was in town in the mid-60s making a film. It's where Bogart and Bacall used to eat 10 years earlier whenever they were in town. So, it's really stupid. You could name drop for, you know, you could name drop for Britain if you'd have just hung around there all the time and kept a note of who you were seeing.
What was the reception for all of this stuff? Like, I know this was going on for decades, but when the rock and roll deal hit, what was the reception nationally? Was it like it was here, really, where the adult population really didn't agree at all, and it was really kind of a rebellion?
Well, it was... Because I think the Beatles, when they first became famous, they were doing establishment things as well as rebelling. I mean, in interviews, they were cheeky and working class, but they also, they played the Royal Command performance. You know, they played in front of Princess Margaret. Can you imagine the Clash or the Sex Pistols 10 years later being invited? And that's
not
where
really.
Brian Epstein was basically getting them into those places. And so miniskirts, the tabloid press, and also the over here in the 60s, and the sort of cheap exploitation films, they loved it because it was a bit risque, but they could get away with saying, mm-hmm. You won't believe what these young people are doing. In the same way that all the major magazines in the States and the newspapers, they loved San Francisco for a while if they were focusing on, oh, look, it's a naked hippie. You know, that you can sell papers doing that. Whereas, and the glam rock fashions, we would see them particularly on Top of the Pops, Slade or these people wearing literally 5 or 6 inch platform heels. You could break your ankles. And most of those came from a shop on the King's Road run by a guy called Terry de Haviland. And it had the best title for a shoe shop in the world. It was called Cobblers to the World, and Cockney rhyming slang or whatever. Cobblers is a nice, it's proper rhyming slang. Cobblers all balls, basically. So it's,
okay.
Yeah. Those were, they were, you know, you'd be sitting watching Top of the Pops, and you'd watch the Suite or somebody staggering around on these things and wearing something that appeared to be entirely made of silver foil. And your parents would disapprove, but they'd also laugh at it. It wasn't considered dangerous. Even when Steve Priest is wearing a First World War German spiked helmet and a swastika armband while singing that. He got away with that singing Blockbuster on Top of the Pops in 1972.
No kidding.
And makeup. The bit where he knew that they'd have to zoom in on him. The bit where the song goes, we just haven't got a clue what to do. and here's a guy with long hair, lipstick, a spiked helmet, and a Nazi armband, and massive, massive stacked heels.
Subtle. Very subtle.
Yeah. And yet, 3 years later, 4 years later, where the Pistols first got on television on again, Granada TV, first with the So It Goes program, Tony Wilson's program, with Jordan wearing a Nazi armband. They went into a lot of trouble for that. And in the pub where they first met, which was called the Roebuck on the King's Road, Jordan said that she used to regularly get thrown out of that pub by the landlord, even though it was quite a rough pub. Some of the older people who used to drink would get offended that she'd come in a swastika armband. It was edgy. But again, Peter O'Toole was drinking that pub as well. Francis Bacon, in his lifetime, is the most, the biggest selling, most expensive artist we had. He's drinking in the same pub as the Sex Pistols, plus a lot of just old geezers with their pints quiet in the corner. And that's why that's where the interesting stuff was going on. Whereas the far end of the King's Road by Sloane Square, where the theatre was, that was expensive. I interviewed Christopher Lee, and he had lived just off Sloane Square ever since the early 60s, right the way through. He was living next door to Boris Karloff.
Oh, my God.
They were good mates.
Terrifying. So,
and I interviewed Chris Lee several times, and I said to him, well, you were watching the whole King's Road parade going by, the swinging 60s. What did you make of that? And he just said, well, to me, it represented a lowering of standards. And I thought, he's probably right. But that's the thing. And then 10 years later, 1972, there's Hammer Films making their groovy update of the Dracula story, Dracula AD 1972.
Yeah, and so good. And so mod.
Died September the 18th, 1872. 100 years ago to the day.
You who witness it must swear before the name of the devil to keep it secret.
Who knows about vampires, for God's sake?
My grandfather died fighting a vampire. The most terrible, the most dangerous vampire of all time.
The year is 1972, a leap year in horror, a vintage year for vampires.
Come, Dracula!
A time for the masters of horror to meet again in the 20th century.
I have returned to destroy you.
Yeah, but you see Peter Cushing wandering down the King's Road, chasing vampires, and Dracula is in a deconsecrated church just south of the King's Road, between the King's Road.
You know, you've got a bit of a fellow obsession with Johnny and myself here with the Rolling Stones. You know, the Rolling Stones, to me, they even with the Ed Sullivan appearances and stuff like that, they came off as like a total mix of like... happening fashion and total slobbery, with the sweatshirts and stuff like that. Any way that you looked at it, the American press, at least in viewing them, as opposed to the Beatles, where, the Beatles, okay, they were weird and odd, but they were in these really nice suits and so on. But here come the Rolling Stones, they're total animals. You didn't want your young teenage girls and the family hanging out or listening to this kind of music. They were deranged and demented and weird.
Yeah. Well, one of the other people I interviewed for my book was an old friend of mine. I knew her since the early 90s. She may well have been a friend of yours. Sadly, we lost her last year, which is Cynthia Plastercaster from Chicago. But she was very good at explaining, I think, the appeal, why she thought these people were dangerous. She loved the fact that they were dangerous. and how she needed to get very near them very quickly, basically. And she needed to know everything simultaneously about how girls in London were dressing, and the frustrations of trying to get a hairdresser in Chicago to cut her hair to look the way she'd seen. She also liked the Beatles. She was one of those people who watched them on the Ed Sullivan show. And she said, it was at that moment I realized I needed to have sex with a Beatle.
Wow.
Still at school. Andrew Lew Goldham is very, very entertaining. I mean, he Johnny, you mentioned fashion being the thing tying everything together. How did Andrew Lou Goldham start? He was a teenage runner and gopher and dog's body for Mary Kwan. And Mary told me that Andrew just basically was this kid who came along and said, I need to work for you. And you've got to let me do this, this, this. In the late 50s. And he was simultaneously holding a gig down at in the evenings working at the London's Hippest Jazz Club, which was Ronnie Scott's. And so he would tip Mary Quant and her husband off if anybody, like, you know, Oscar Peterson or whoever was coming through town, and he'd get them in. And they'd hop in a cab from Chelsea and just go to Soho to see that. So you flash forward to 1962, the Beatles are getting famous over here, but they're still living in Liverpool. But they start needing to do press. So they're having to come to London and they need somewhere to stay. Where do they stay? The Sloane Square Hotel, which is right there at this end of the King's Road by the Royal Court Theatre. And who is their PR dog's body that the senior guy's not looking after them? It's Andrew Oldham sent to take them around, just, you know, show them to the interviews, whatever. And from watching that and watching the way the Beatles conducted themselves, he then shortly afterwards met the Stones, who were living at the less expensive end of the King's Road in Edith Grove, in a really grotty squat, basically, house. And he put a lot of those lessons into practice, the way he'd seen it work with what Brian Epstein was doing and how he had dealt with this sudden explosion of it. But he definitely thought, if those guys are the clean people you can take home to mum, let's go the other way. Let's have the bad guy. You know, if this one is Marlon Brando in The Wild One, let's make these guys Lee Marvin, who was the really scuzzy one, you know, the really dangerous one.
Mm-hmm. Right. And it wasn't just the teenage girls who were going for this look. It was the teenage boys, and it was also a sophisticated element who wanted them into the possibly their boring cocktail parties and so on.
Yeah. I quote, you may know it, it wasn't a bootleg, it was pressed. You know those American radio pressings shows where you've got the complete show? They're called Rock Around the World. Okay. And I've got a it's a 1977 one. So it's a complete live show with all of the station breaks and the adverts. And it's from Iggy's Idiot Tour, the one where Bowie's on keyboards, and recorded at Santa Monica Civic. And Iggy is being interviewed in between the tracks. And he said, he's talking about his young days. And he said, there was a time, and he's mentioning exactly what you're talking about, watching the Stones in 63 or 64. He said, I could turn on my television and watch the Rolling Stones, and I could learn something about how to talk, how to dress, how to dance, and how to act. Just from just good music. I had the whole thing going. And he said, because we're in the punk days, he's saying this in 1977. He said, kids these days don't really need that. They can get their information from all sorts of places. But if you were him in Ann Arbor, Michigan, watching, you know, you're at school and you watch the Stones on Shindig or wherever, whatever was available at that time, you're getting a whole lesson. And certainly that, the reason I quote that is because some of what was coming out of the King's Road at key times that you were seeing on television, you were getting the total package, that attitude.
I love that, Iggy, talking about kids these days, because you can use that commentary at any point in time, and it's so true, and never so true as now, when any information pretty much is discernible, and there's still so much buried information, and we really appreciate you, for instance, in going the extra mile to dig up these tie-ins between fashion, music, film, actors, performers, artists of all sorts in a really small strip of real estate in London. And yeah, you described it, that really meant King's Road. But King's Road was really the turf of the, for lack of a better word, the mods, right? The modernists, the people who were pushing the envelope with look and music.
I suppose it's difficult because the word mod, I try and get into that actually in my book, which is that the word mod becomes, it takes on a life of its own. And, you know, a mod over here was someone in a particular Italian-inspired suit, you know, with narrow lapels and this many buttons and all of this. And if you need transport, then it's a Vespa or it's a Lambretta or whatever it is.
Right.
And to protect your suit, then an ex-US, Parker. But you look at what happens to the word mod by the mid-60s, and particularly once it goes international. And then a couple of years later, once you've got the American TV series, The Mod Squad, it's got damn all to do with anybody in an Italian suit on a scooter.
Yes.
Mod just became a shorthand for, if you were in, I mean, the 60s worshipped the new completely.
Yeah.
You know, you demolish some nice old buildings that didn't need demolishing. And then you build everything they were building around where I was growing up. It was just concrete, concrete, concrete. That was it. You know, even buildings that had survived the bombing and the war, they knocked them down anyway, just because new was good and old. The worst thing you could say to anybody was that it was old-fashioned. Your house might have a lovely old Victorian fireplace, you know, hand-carved marble. You rip that out, you just put a gas heater in there or something like that because it's new. If you were looking for whatever the new fashion was, you would go down the King's Road. And, of course, that changed year by year. So,
right. The rockers made a comeback when Malcolm McLaren put a lot of that stuff in the Let It Rock, right?
Absolutely.
Including the records.
Yeah. And that was, I interviewed the great Ted Carroll, who started Rock On and then Chiswick Records. And Ted, as he told me, you know, I mean, he's a Teddy boy. His real name's David. He was a schoolboy Ted in the mid 50s. And because he wore that gear, his mates at school started calling him Ted. He's been Ted ever since. He was really the rock and roll consultant. He knew Malcolm and Vivian. They set up in the back of a shop at 430 King's Road in 1971. And McLaren had seen, I mean, there was a rock and roll revival there. I mean, people like Gene Vincent, Gene was living over here half in the 60s. He'd always been big. The rock and roll people over here, they never lost touch, but they always went to see Jerry Lee, Gene Vincent, Bo Diddley, you know, Little Richard. Sometimes when people like that didn't have an audience back in the States, they could come over here and play to decent-sized crowds. And so you had a thing called the Wembley Rock and Roll Festival, but you also had various bubblings up of the rock and roll revival as the 60s was ending. So I think Malcolm was seeing that there's something in the wind, but also it's a way of winding people up because most people were not doing that. Mm-hmm. If you've got hippies, then what's the opposite of hippies? In this country, Ted's were. Plus, it's a great look. It's really.
Mm-hmm. It is.
Ted Carroll was already importing vintage rock and roll records over here. He, you know, that these people were selling old Sun Records stock in Memphis. I think it was Selecto Hit was selling
Selecto Hits,
10
right.
cents or something. Mm-hmm. And he told me he found a great place in, I don't know, Connecticut or somewhere else. And he was importing these things. And he did deals with Malcolm McLaren where Malcolm would pay some money up front. And so Ted could order, say, 1,040 vintage rock and roll 45s, bring them over, and Ted, on his scooter, would go to Heathrow Airport, the main airport outside London, pick up these vintage singles, bring them back to London, and sell some of them to Malcolm for about four times what he paid for them.
And nice
then Malcolm, Malcolm would sell them for about another four times what he just bought them off Ted for. Okay. And that was the stock. If you walked into Let It Rock when it first opened, you've got the Teddy Boy clothing, but then everything else, you've got Billy Fury posters, Gene Vincent posters, vintage records, you've got an old jukebox. That was that was Ted Cowan. What came out of Chelsea was some wonderfully original stuff, both in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, but then a lot of people moving there and jumping on the bandwagon.
Right.
You know, once when you might have a great boutique, but then you've got somebody thinking, I can make money selling any old rubbish to these kids, and I can stick a really huge price tag on it. So you've always got the places that might open one year and close the next, or things that don't quite come off. I haven't mentioned yet the Chelsea drugstore, which was that was a purpose-built, this is where all the hip people are going to go. And when they opened, they had a team of people. It was nearly 24 hours a day, which for London, for England in those days, we didn't have much that was 24 hours a day. But they had a team of sort of Honor Blackman, Avengers kind of women in cat suits, leather cat suits on motorbikes. You could order something and these people would deliver it to you from the Chelsea drugstore. And of course, it winds up in the Stones song that year, 1969, Can't Always Get What You Want. And then 2 years after that, 3 years after that, it's the record shop where
boutique.
Malcolm McDowell in Clockwork Orange, where he picks up the two women. Yeah. And yet, it still never really caught on. And by the mid-80s, it became what it is. It's still there. Yeah. It's a McDonald's. It's been a McDonald's for 35 years.
Oh, what an insult.
There were always these people trying to be hip. Like, you've got seditionaries in the mid-70s, but then you've got Boy, which was sort of what Acme Attractions had been, but it was trying to really be what McLaren and Westwood were doing, but doing a slightly more, let's tone it down a bit and let's get it more mainstream. They went into the 80s and started getting into the, you know, the dance culture clothing and, you know, baggy sweatshirts and branded baseball caps. Whereas originally that was a punk shop. But again, even at the time, I thought, well, Boy's not quite the real thing. It was giving off for me. Mm-hmm. I mean, what did I know? I'm like 16, 17, but there was an awful lot of bandwagon jumping going on in the punk days, just as there was, you know, once the Beatles and the Stones were selling huge amounts, then let's get ourselves a bowl cut and dress up this way and maybe we can have a hit record or whatever it is.
The end of the book, or you said the focus of the book kind of ends with punk. And yeah. So it seems
once,
to me...
Once punk's really, really... if it's a rocket going up, it's already lit up the sky and sure. It's on its way.
Yeah, there's a very small shelf life with punk rock.
Yeah, which is not to say you can't draw a really great influence from it these days in the same way that you can draw a great influence from rockabilly. You know, if you're forming a punk band, say, in 1981, there were lots of people doing that over here. Those people were already trying to sound like The Clash or trying to sound like The Buzzcocks or trying to sound like
The Ramones. Which was four years before that, right?
Yeah, exactly. 1979, although that's the beginnings of the 12 Maps album career, that's where my book finishes. Mm-hmm. And that seemed symbolic to me because we had this one politician who'd been living... we mentioned Chelsea Manor Studios and the Sgt. Pepper cover being photographed there in 67. In the early 70s, a politician moved there, and you could tell where she lived because she was the leader of the opposition. So that's, she's not in government, but she's the head of the main party opposing over here. So you've got two London policemen standing outside 24 hours a day on guard. And in 1979, she got the big prize and became prime minister. So she moved from Chelsea to Downing Street, and that's Margaret Thatcher. Chelsea, by that stage, had become where the super rich were living and where, you know, the classic how Lux introduces You've Got Good Taste on the Smell of Female live recording. He just goes, this one's for all you Gucci bag carriers out there. That's where you were going to find them by the 80s. The Gucci bag carriers were going to be trawling up and down the King's Road. Not Brian Jones in 67, who was living on the King's Road above one of the main. He was living above the Quorum Boutique, which was one of the great boutiques you could get. If you didn't go to Mary Quant's place, Quorum for women's clothing was one of the places you went. And all of that had really gone. So That was, to me, Thatcher moving there and punk having sort of shot its bolt and everything getting more expensive. I thought a good end point, because compared to people looking to, in the 50s, 60s or 70s, looking to Chelsea for something new or groundbreaking or dangerous, the 80s, it was different.
So yeah. I mentioned though the punk as being sort of one of the bookends, of course, the politics, as you talked about. But yeah, as far as the punk is concerned, that's sort of the end of King's Road as the cool hip stuff, right? I mean, from that point on, it became sort of like what you had mentioned. Yeah. And then from what it is now, it's like full of McDonald's, yeah, Starbucks and stuff like that. But so you say that the punk was sort of the end of that, you know, because of the fact that things with punk were, like I said, have such a short shelf life. It's like, yeah, once it becomes cool, it's already not cool. And so when you're trying to catch up and you're putting your stuff in the shops, it's like by the time it's in the shops, besides maybe with West, yeah, it's like, you know, it's old. Nobody wants it anymore. At least the cool kids don't want it anymore. You know?
Yeah, exactly. And for me, as I said before, making your own clothes, you know, literally carving your clothes up with a big pair of dressmaking scissors and then stitching them back together by hand very badly and then writing slogans along. This is the kind of stuff I was doing. And I asked TV Smith from the adverts, I said, did you guys have anything from seditionaries or sex or whatever? And he just went, God, no, we couldn't afford that.
Yeah.
You know, because it was, they were aiming at the haute couture market, which is where Vivian eventually went, basically. Paris catwalks, £6,000 for a dress or something. That's really what it was. And he said the only item of clothing they had was that Malcolm once gave Gay Advert a pair of trousers from seditionaries, because he thought it would be a good advert for the shop. You know, she'd be photographed in the papers with them. And that's why you would always see the Pistols wandering around in this stuff. They were not having to buy it, but they were a walking advert for the shop. As the 80s went on, yeah, there were still good things down the King's Road, but mostly there were things that had been there for a while. For me, the last great clothing shop was Johnson's. Johnson's, the Modern Outfitters, run by Lloyd Johnson. He opened that in 1978, and he is a genuine early 60s mod. He, you know, he was a scooter riding, thin lapel. He's the real deal. So by the time you get to him opening his shop in 78, if you've ever seen, for instance, the clip of Nick Lowe on Top of the Pops doing I Love the Sound of Breaking Glass, and he's in a very sharp shark skin green suit, done up as the Riddler from the 66 Batman TV series with the question marks on it. That's a suit from Johnson's. And then when the two-tone people come along the following year, Madness, the Specials, the Selector, and they're all wearing very early 60s sharkskin or mohair, very, very narrow trousers. That's where they're getting them from. They're getting them from Roy Johnson's shop. I used to go in there after 2 years being on the dole. I finally got my first job in 1983. And the first thing I did was go back down the King's Road and buy a silver mohair suit from Johnson's, which with my first pay, it basically killed my first month's pay packet. But I'd been staring through the window at these things for 2 years of not being able to afford anything and thinking, when I've got some money, I'll do that.
What did that suit cost you?
That cost me £65 in 1983. And to put that into context, in my years on the dole, I had been living on £18 a week. That's for everything. That's food, clothing, rent, the lot, in London, which was not a cheap city. And these days, it's a tragedy. By the time I started writing my book in 2004, there were four different branches of Starbucks on the King's Road, and it's not a long street. Yeah. Whereas it had really hip first generation 50s coffee bars. You know, when coffee bars, Italian style with the great Gaggia machines, you in 40s Britain, you couldn't get an espresso or, you know, a proper Italian coffee. You just couldn't. But by the mid 50s, you could, if you knew where to go. Some people showed up at my first launch, and then some people showed up at my second launch, which is to say 2005, and then this year over here. And they pretty much got me by the throat, these different people, just saying, I ran a shop down the King's Road for 5 years in 1982. And then, why am I not in your book? You know, it's like, it's not an encyclopedia and it's not 5,000 words of pages long. It's not a list of every shop that was ever there, because that seriously would be huge. It's trying to focus on the really groundbreaking stuff and also tell an interesting story, and not for it not just to be a list. The thing, as you could probably tell from reading it, the thing that was always doing my head in and that I was struggling with is how much actually happened there. You know, it's Bowie's living there when he's doing A Lad Insane. Bolan is living there in 74, doing some of his great later LPs. Keith Rich and Nita Pallenberg are living there when she's shooting Performance with Mick Jagger. Mick Jagger's living there at the same time. They're two doors down from the house where Rossetti was living with Swinburne in the mid-19th century. But that is the house where Vincent Price smothers Diana Dawes to death in the 1973 film Theatre of Blood. That's Rossetti's house. And the party scene in Blow Up, a friend of mine, I knew him for years before he told me he's in the party scene in Blow Up in 1965. And that is in a house just south of King's Road, and so on. You could wander around that area and you just go, okay, this is where Bram Stoker wrote Dracula, around the corner from that. This is where Mark Twain was living in the late 19th century. Who was his neighbor about 100 yards away? Oscar Wilde, when he was writing all of his plays. It just goes on. It's absolutely nuts. So if I had actually mentioned everybody who ran a shop or was the landlord of a pub during the key decades I'm talking about, it would be a massive, massive book.
Did you want to talk about your music a little bit? I know you came out with a new album last year.
Yes.
Yeah, that was a solo album I've made. I've been on records since the late 70s. I've been in bands. I was in teenage bands in the punk years, 76 onwards. But I really... First time I ever went touring internationally and started really getting into this, that was with Nicky Sutton. He actually rang me up one day. I'd known him for a few years, but I'd never played with him. And he said, this is 1990, he said, my drummer's just left, you're a drummer. I've got a tour starting in Japan next week, and then 3 weeks in Germany. Can you do it? And I said, yes. So I learned 40 songs in a week. And and then a year later, I joined Gallon Drunk, just as that was all starting to take off. And we toured everywhere. We were on the Morrissey tour across the States and Canada in 92. So we did two nights at the Hollywood Bowl. We did the Paramount in New York, which was the smaller room at Madison Square Garden. So that's what, 6,000 people or something like that. It was just nuts. So, but I kept a tour diary all the way through that, and I took lots of photographs, and I kept loads of, you know, backstage passes, memorabilia. So I've got the full story, which is why I now put things like that up on Facebook. We came back the following year with PJ Harvey, just as she was really taking off. So we played the Academy in 43rd Street in 93, and we were in the middle of the bill, and the opening act was some little band from Oxford over here. I don't know whatever happened to them. They're called Radiohead. I mean, I think they just disappeared. But that was, yeah. So did a lot of stuff like that. And then in 94, I'd left Gallon Drunk, and so then started the Flaming Stars. That was basically 25 years. Being in a band, as you know, it's like being married to a whole bunch of different people at the same time. And it pulls in loads of different directions. And in general, we actually got on with each other.
I was just going to ask you about your latest record.
Yeah, all the records I've made, I've always either been the singer or the drummer or the piano player or whatever. And the name on the record has been the name of a band. This is the first thing, after 40 years, this is the first thing that's just had my name on it. And I played all the instruments, I've sang them, and it's all songs that I've written. So it's very low key, very late night mostly, and it's no kind of a giant leap away from, if people have heard what I've done in any of those bands, it kind of makes sense. There's just a pleasure in being the only one on a record, because then you don't, if a song only needs, it just needs a piano, or maybe just a piano and an organ, and that's it. Or just, I mean, I'm a drummer, but some songs don't need a whole lot of drums. They might just need, you know, like on Pale Blue Eyes, you just have the tambourine just doing that, and that's it. And that's what that song needed. And if you're in a five-piece band, then sometimes you have to find a reason for all of those five people. You know, there's got to be something for everybody to do. The point about this was just for me to say, okay, what happens if I just want it to be this simple? I don't have to discuss that with them. The French label, great French label called Danger House Skylab, who put that out, and they did a beautiful job of it. And so I'm hoping, as Mr. Bogart said in Casablanca, I'm hoping it's the start of a beautiful friendship.
I hope you're able to come to the States with that too.
I'd love to come back and do something. You know, it's always difficult to set these things up, but there's when I launched the new edition of King's Road at the Omnibus Press, their offices, which is really quite grand, and they've got this huge reception area because they do a lot of music publishing. So they've got a very, very nice grand piano sitting there in their entrance hall. And we had the book launch there. So that was an invited audience. And I did a little bit of a talk, and every so often I stopped, sat down at the grand piano. So I did three songs, 150s, 160s, 170s. So I did Freight Train by the Chas McDeppitt Skiffle Group, just me and a piano. Because the Rolling Stones, when they were still living on the King's Road, that's where they met. We were introduced to Marianne Faithfull at the Chelsea party, and they wrote As Tears Go By for her. So I did As Tears Go By, just on a piano. And then the Sex Pistols, absolutely taking the piss out of Malcolm McLaren in the song 17. You know, the one that goes, you're only 29, got a lot to learn, but when your business dies, that's sedition raise, it will not return. So, just me and the grand piano trying to recreate the 1977 Sex Pistols. That was a challenge. It was fun. But it's fun just doing something which is just you, or maybe just you and me. So hopefully more in the future.
Max Décharné, thank you so much for being with us on Waterloo Underground.
Thank you again for asking me. It's been a total pleasure. It really has.
It's been a blast.